There were three of us involved there in the wilds of Africa. First, there was the leopard, beautiful, elusive, one of the most dangerous creatures on Earth. Then there was Elmon Mhlongo, tracker and friend. I was the third character in the story. I was the photographer. I soon realized that this was a very special leopard, a female who in the last 8 years had raised no less than 5 litters of cubs. She was an incredible mother, amazing hunter and athlete, capable of lifting kills equal to her own weight high into the trees. Elmon and I followed her night and day, always respecting her wildness and freedom. You don't find men like Elmon anymore. He's the last of a dying breed. He never went to school, but in my opinion, he's a genius, reading the ways of the animals like a book. We faced many hardships and dangers together. We came to respect each other, and to respect the leopard too. For she was allowing us into her very own private world, a world previously unknown to us. You see, I was the outsider. I was watching the tracker, and I was watching the leopard. And I've called my story The Silent Hunter.
For 5 long years, it had become habit with them. Up at dawn to search for the leopard.
So far, Mama.
But now the track has gone cold. For 3 weeks, no sign of her. In the back of their minds is the dreaded thought that she might be dead, shot for her pelt, or perhaps slain by a lion at a kill. But the men never give up. They check all her normal haunts. Listen for her call. Nothing. They search riverbeds, favorite waterholes, and hunting grounds. Still nothing.
Madale.
Eventually, the tracker, drawing on primeval instincts, suggests they consult a witch doctor. John, knowing Africa's dark powers, agrees. The witch doctor throws the bones, the matumbo, the small bones of animals said to possess magic properties. From the way the bones fall at each throw, he divines answers to what the men seek, while they observe the solemn ritual of crying, "Siavoma, we agree." The leopard is alive and well, the witch doctor declares. She has left the old place to be with a male. She is mating with a male, and it is because he now protects her that she leaves the old place. Go to the river, he commands. Go to the river, my friends. To follow a mating male leopard into thick reeds is to court death. Within moments, the two men were to learn this. Calls off the charge. Leopards are creatures of the night. Knowing this, the men wait by the river, hoping the male will be more relaxed in the dark, less aggressive. Eventually, the mating pair is sighted.
Jesus, man.
A fire caused by an electrical fault costs the shot of a lifetime.
Lampo,
Pelit.
Yeah, I see.
Oh, it's gone, man.
To get into that situation, to have actually had the leopards and then worked your way after 3 days and three nights working solidly on it, and eventually at 2:30 in the morning, to get into a situation where you can finally get a shot which no other human being has ever got, and then see the thing go up in smoke. Well, it's suicidal stuff, man.
For 3.5 months, she has carried the cubs inside her. Now her own body, her instincts, tell her it is time. A suitable den must be found for the birth. Ant bear holes in termite mounds, the banks of dry river beds, and fallen trees are checked. John and Elmon deduct from her tracks that the mother is away hunting and that she has left the cubs in a rocky outcrop, inaccessible, seemingly safe from all. In order to film the 2-week-old cubs, they decide their only chance is to descend into the dry riverbed whilst the mother is away hunting. I think a few years ago I would have destroyed that hyena, but today I felt I should just sit back and be an outsider, be an observer, and try and learn from the situation instead of just taking out a gun and blowing that hyena away.
Mm.
A hyena has a right to live. And basically what was happening was just a natural situation. It's occurred many, many times in the history of both animals. And the cubs were probably gaining a learning experience from that. And if you'd intervened, they might have been killed later in their life. I think man, especially Western man, invades. So many times we invade ecosystems, river systems, and even cultures without understanding the side effects of our actions.
Aware now of the great danger from the spotted hyena, she moves her litter to a new and inaccessible den. Returning by a different route, she carries her young one by one. Now suckling two growing and ever demanding cubs, the mother must eat regularly to sustain herself. Trees are used from which to sight prey, and the hunt is on. Hearing, sight, and scent combine to perfection in the leopard to locate the prey. Experience blends with endless patience as she plots her approach. Cunning and stealth move her ever closer. The impala is aware of danger. Will it run? No, the leopard is camouflaged by the dappled shade of long grass and trees. Closer. Now she crouches, contracting her muscles in order to hurtle her 40-kilogram frame across those last 20 meters at a speed swift enough to blur the sight. The leopard hunts alone, and the kill must be made silently so as not to attract other predators big enough or numerous enough to steal the kill from her. Her canine teeth block the impala's windpipe in order to prevent the distress call. The buck is moved undercover and out of sight of the prying eyes of vultures that would signal to all the position of the kill. Great energy has been expended during the kill, and only after resting she will begin to feed, which also helps lighten the burden of lifting the impala into a tree later. Grass is roughage and aids digestion. The intestines are covered to prevent the smell of the kill from spreading, but the wind betrays her, and the alert hyena start moving in. They can drive her from the prey, and she knows this. Climbing ability and phenomenal strength make the leopard one of the most efficient predators in all of Africa. Now, over the next few days, she will feed at leisure, while the hyena must be content with the scraps dropped from her kill.
You're a prince of the grassland, built only for speed. You're a symbol of freedom, you're a last dying breed. You have power and presence, you're adapted and free. And the eyes look right through you, you're king in the trees. Such poetry in motion as he speeds through the grass. Such power and strength as he lifts his own mass. So long may you live, your secret untold. May you go on forever and never grow old.
For several weeks, John and Elmon have left the mother undisturbed. Now the men are anxious to see that the cubs are alive and well. Eventually, they locate her in one of her favorite dry river beds. For 14 weeks, she will suckle the cubs, but by 10 weeks, they're already feeding off meat. Grooming assists the circulation, as well as cooling down the cubs, and maintains their social bonds. The mother's saliva on their coats, when exposed to sunlight, produces vitamin D. The instinct to climb is already apparent in the young animals, a necessity for survival in the face of other predators. Confidence grows. They begin to explore further afield from the safety of the den. Playing is vital to the cubs. During play, they learn the essential techniques of stalking, pouncing and killing. Although prone to falling heavily, their suppleness prevents serious injury. And by 3 months, their play is almost reckless. And as they grow, the mother will leave them for longer periods on their own. Now is the time for the cubs to hunt the small prey. For unlike the other predators, which have to learn by example, the leopard teaches itself. And it is these self-taught skills, acquired when making these smaller kills, that will shape the animal into the most efficient and independent hunter in Africa. The ability to climb stands the young female in good stead as she spies a monitor lizard high in an acacia tree. although it relies on its near-perfect camouflage to escape detection. The leopard's acute eyesight has pinpointed the monitor. However, the female tires of the game. But for the lizard, its troubles have just begun, as the young male leopard takes up the attack with enthusiasm. In this instance, the reptile's patience was rewarded, and it escaped. The cub is now just 4 months old and has more success as he makes his first kill, a banded mongoose. Closely related to the mongoose is the nocturnal civet. The young male catches the civet sleeping in the rocks. Although his prey is almost his own weight, the cub dispatches the civet swiftly, then plays with his kill. Leopards disdain the flesh of other predators, and the kill is not eaten. At night, the cubs become far more active, their night vision allowing them to see clearly in 1/6 of the light needed by the human eye. The young leopard strikes. Sight, sound and scent all combine to locate a hare. But then he has no real idea what to do next. Ah, of course, climb a tree with it, just like Mum. Easy. Not so easy. In the end, a high termite mound is the face-saving answer. By 6 months, the two cubs have very obviously developed speed and agility. Games are far rougher now, far more serious. Mother gives daughter a lesson in the art of stand-up fighting. When used in earnest, the leopard's dew claw can cause considerable damage. September, and in the bushveld the fuchsia flowers are in bloom, their abundant sweet nectar attracting troops of monkeys. So engrossed are they in the feast that they fail to see the young male leopard in a nearby tree. One of them foolishly strays, and in a flash, the leopard has him. But in his inexperience, he goes for the back of the neck instead of the front, and his canines are not long enough for him to inflict a fatal wound. He then makes a second and equally serious error. He releases his grip for a moment. The monkey flees to safety, with more hurt done to his pride than anything else, while the leopard contemplates one lesson he won't forget in a hurry. The porcupine, Africa's largest rodent, can dangerously threaten the leopard. The longer quills act as sensory organs, and when they are touched, the porcupine is triggered into thrusting viciously backwards, impaling an attacker on the smaller, harder, and sharper quills at the base of the tail. Luckily, the cub is able to bite the quills out. Now more cautious but undeterred, the male refuses to give up. The porcupine resolutely keeps his rear towards the cub and stamps his feet to rattle the quills ominously. The female literally licks her wounds and watches her brother risk his life and his eyesight, as in utter frustration, he lies down next to the porcupine, little realizing the danger of a thrust of a quill to the eye, impalement, and even blindness. Another very real danger to the leopard is the poisonous snake. The young male spots an Egyptian cobra and begins to stalk, unaware of the death in those fangs. The snake rears, hood distended, almost inviting the cub in. But instinct warns the cub that this is one creature best left alone. The mother leopard is hunting again, and John and Elmon, eager to film the kill, follow her fresh tracks. The distress call of a young impala indicates the leopard has struck near at hand. As always with leopard kills, the heavy terrain hampers pursuit. A hyena has harassed her into a tree, and in her haste to kill, the leopard has not been able to apply her usual suffocating grip to the front of the throat. The subsequent calls of distress by the impala have brought more hyenas swiftly to the kill. Once again, agility, the ability to climb, and pure strength have diffused a confrontation with an age-old competitor. She fetches the cubs from their position nearby. The male immediately mock kills the already dead impala. He then repositions the carcass. All of this is a dress rehearsal for later life. The hyenas know that this is their best chance, for the cub, being inexperienced, is quite likely to drop the kill. However, once again, the frustrated hyenas are out of luck. The demands of the ever-growing cubs are enormous, and the mother must ensure that she gets her share of the kill to keep up her strength, because the cubs are still entirely dependent on her. Because they feed off a kill for several days, leopards are at risk from the many parasites that breed in decaying meat. Consequently, they groom each other meticulously, even biting away the ticks. After the grooming, the family moves to a water hole, where the mother checks for danger before going to the water. The danger call of the kudu indicates that another feared predator is on the move, a lioness, which has smelled the meat and is moving towards the kill. John and Elmon investigate the cause and discover the predator, another competitor that can and will climb when necessary. Although not as agile as the leopard, she is capable of climbing to 30 feet or so to rob a kill. For months, the men have been out of touch with civilization. Supplies are running low, and they are down to their last roll of film. The cubs are now 12 months old. Their social ties to their mother are weakening, and soon she will leave them to fend for themselves. The male is now in fact heavier than his own mother, and he and his sister are capable of killing smaller game. Here the male catches a female impala. It is a bare 5 months since his attempt to kill a monkey, and he has now learnt to go straight for the throat and kill swiftly and silently. Freed from the constraints imposed on her by the cubs, and spurred on by hormonal changes, the mother, calling for the dominant male, moves through her territory, marking the boundaries with a fluid sprayed from under the tail. The men know she will behave as she did before, crossing her territorial boundary under the protection of the male. And sure enough, they find tracks of the pair crossing the river. John and Elmon, using the Land Rover, cross the river, hoping to capture, for the first time on film, leopards mating in the wild. And a half months later, nature's cycle is repeated. The new litter of cubs is due, and John and Elmon are eager to catch a glimpse of them. Fresh tracks of a female leopard are found, but superimposed on top are the tracks of humans, poachers.
Mm.
Contrary to popular belief, it is not poaching or the fur trade that is causing the decline of leopards in Africa. The exploding human population, estimated to double in the next 20 years to 1 billion people, will, in an attempt to feed itself, convert the last of the leopard's home range to agriculture. Not even the leopard, adaptable as it is, can survive if its habitat and food supply are destroyed.
John and Elman discover that it is not the mother, but a nomadic leopard passing through that has been poached. And the next day, fresh tracks reveal that the mother is alive and well. Once again, they search her favorite dry riverbeds and den sites. And once again, they find her and her family. The silent hunter.
Come on,